Welcome everyone. This is a 1 hour webinar entitled VRay Advanced. My name is Brian Smith from 3DATS and the CG School. This is a 1 hour presentation designed to be a small sampling of a larger 18 hour class offered at the CG School. If you would like to learn more information about the classes offered at the CG School, please visit the website you see on your screen there. This is an advanced class, as it says, and because it's an advanced class, the information that I will be presenting is going to be pretty complex, and if you're a beginner or a new user to VRay, you will probably be lost in a lot of the areas. I'm going to be throwing out a lot of information very fast, and the information is not going to be presented in the normal fashion it is presented in a class. This is a 1 hour class, and it's not much time to cover very many subjects, but I'm going to try to cover as many subjects as I can and throw as much information out as possible. And because it's an advanced level class, it is conducive to that type of environment, and hopefully everybody can learn something from this. One quick note about the machine that I'll be working on. This is a GoBox from Box Computers. It is a brand new machine, new out of the factory. It's a 6-core mobile workstation. Very new. It was just developed in the last month. It has 6 physical cores, 12 virtual cores when combined with hyper-threading. It's an Intel i7-980 with 12 gigabytes of RAM. So all in all, it's a pretty fast machine, and it's very great for being on the road, which is where I am right now. The other reason this class is particularly the reason why this class is pretty unique for me is because I'm doing this live from the Chaos headquarters in Sofia, Bulgaria. So, long way from home, having a great time here. And with that, let's go ahead and get started. One more quick note about the scenes that I'll be presenting in this webinar. This is a Go box, and it is very fast, and you're going to see 12 different processors running behind the scenes and 12 buckets rendering, but still, when you're given a live class and you only have 1 hour to work with, it doesn't leave much time for dead air, and I don't like wasting your time. So I'm going to keep the scenes fairly small, and in some cases do render regions, but for the most part, these scenes are pretty streamlined and easy to work with. Well, let's real quick look at the agenda for this particular class. And here is the agenda. We're going to be talking about image sampling first, by far the most important area of VRay. Then we're going to move quickly into GI engines and talk for about 10 minutes on various GI engines. And again, this is advanced. If you're new, you're probably going to be lost in this particular area. But if you are an advanced user, intermediate level user that's been working with VRay for some time, you certainly have some things that you'll probably be able to pick up here. Next, we're going to move into the DMC sampler, progressive path tracing, the raycaster parameters that you find in the system rollout. We'll cover some of the important features there. VRay frame buffer, you might not realize some of the new things that's in that VRay frame buffer. We're going to look at that. Render elements, a couple new features inside the render elements area. Raw image files and AA filters, anti-aliasing filters. Now, this is not a comprehensive at all view of VRay. It is just a sampling. It is just several different features to give a pretty good variety of the features in VRay and some of the things you can learn if you take this longer 18-hour course. So with that, let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to render the scene as is. This is a pretty simple 4-story house, and it is going to be rendering with some pretty decent radiance map and light cast settings, which is by far the most widely used combination for GI. What you'll see, even though this is pretty good settings, I'll show you the settings in a second, even though these are good GI settings, the image quality itself is pretty poor, and it's because of the image sampler. You could have the absolute best configuration of settings, GI, shadows, lights, color mapping, and everything else, but if your image sampling is not set correctly, you're going to lose everything. And not only that, it is probably the most important area because it is the biggest has the biggest contribution to time in a rendering when you factor in what you put in and what you get out. So if you don't handle image sampling correctly, you're going to be suffering. Hopefully, if you're an advanced level user or intermediate level user, you've you've learned that adaptive subdivision is probably not the image sampler to use for production renderings. This is a production rendering, but I'm using the adaptive subdivision image sampler. The adaptive subdivision image sampler is great for test renderings and great in the configuration you see here. When I do a test render, I always use adaptive subdivision with the default test render settings. Before I go any farther, I want to show you an image. And I'm having to move behind the scenes in several different windows because it's such a it's a different machine. I'm not entirely used to it. Here is a box with a drastic aliased edge to it. And that edge has a aliased edge because there are only so many pixels that can be displayed on a screen. And so VRay has to accommodate this jagged aliased look by using a process called image sampling. Now, if you use just one subdivision for, say, the fixed image sampler, you're going to get one sample at the center of each pixel. You can't subdivide or you can't color a pixel smaller than the entire pixel. You can't color part of a pixel one color and part of another pixel another color. You cannot do that. All you can do is subdivide. This dashed line represents the edge of that box. And all VRay knows is, at the center of each pixel, what does it see? Well, at the center of this pixel, it sees the green box. At the center of this pixel, it sees the white background. So for this pixel, it shades the entire pixel green. This pixel, it shades the entire pixel white. Well, that's what you would get if you use one subdivision. You would get a very jagged, aliased look to your entire scene. If I set my image sampler to fixed and used one subdivision, I would get a very jagged, fairly ugly looking scene. No matter how good my GI and the rest of my settings are in VRay. If I go up to two subdivisions, I am subdividing each pixel twice, which gives me four subpixel samples. And so there is a sample taken at the center of each subpixel sample. So in the case of this pixel, you have three out of the four pixels detecting the green box, one detecting the white background. So what does it do? It can't, like I said, it cannot shade pixel in this fashion that you see here. The only thing it can do is recolor the pixels a certain amount to give it a more gradual change, a gradient at the edge. And that color that you see here is 75%, roughly 75% of the color, the original color of the original green box. The pixel to the right of it only detects the green box in one of the four subpixel samples. So only 25% of these subpixel samples are detecting the green box, and the result is 25% color of the original solid green that you see down here. In the next image, you see three subdivisions, which yields nine subpixel samples. And you have six subpixel samples here detecting the green box, three detecting the white background, and as a result, 66% colorization. So all this subdivision is doing behind the scenes, regardless of whether it's fixed adaptive subdivision or adaptive DMC, is to arrive at the best possible pixel color for any given pixel. And if you ever wonder why movies like special effects in movies or movies like Shrek, which are fully animated, or other full animation movies have such beautiful, crisp, artifact-free video, it's because, not necessarily because of the image sampling, but because of the higher resolution that they will render with, which when converted down to a DVD or even high definition, will yield the same result as image sampling. Most movies are shot now in 4K Academy, which is 4,096 pixels by 2,048 pixels. And so when you render an image that large, you're going to get very good image sampling when you end up converting it down to a smaller image. So that is what image sampling is all about. Going back to the different image sampler types that you have here, you have adaptive subdivision, which should really, in my opinion, only be used for test renders for several reasons, not the least of which that it is not designed to render glossy reflections and glossy refractions very well. For that alone, you probably want to stay away from it. It is the only one that allows you to go less than one sample per pixel. So instead of doing one sample per pixel, it will group a set of four pixels and take one sample at the center.